The next test I've chosen is to look at the wideband oxygen sensor or air fuel sensor. I've left the car running, I've set the test up, I've left the car running because I want the residual temperature in the exhaust system to stay high to get a good response from the lambda sensor. So it's to confirm the correct fuel trim, the correct response from the oxygen sensor, to establish correct function of a 5-wire air fuel sensor, and also then to compare it with load request. Load request is the air mass meter, which we've just discussed. We're going to bring the two of them together. So the first comment, the air fuel sensor or wideband air fuel sensor or USD sensor, because the wideband oxygen sensor works off current differential across two cells. It's two zirconia cells and it's current differential, the exchange of oxygen molecules across those two cells, which determines the correct oxygen content in the exhaust. So the net accumulation of that is that the ECU looks at current, not voltage. However, with the general 5-wire European Bosch style sensor, we can measure voltage. So I'd like to show you how to use simple voltage as the means of diagnosis, and then just confirm what happens with current, which is what the ECU looks at. So we're going to look at both. But you can do this with simple voltage. A lot of people, including some of the people who actually produce these devices, claim you can't do that. Well, I'm afraid they're wrong. We can do it, and we're going to do it. However, if it's a 4-wire sensor, which generally are the Denso sensors on your Asian cars, your Volvos and some Fords, I do agree with 4 wires, you can only measure current easily, either by direct measurement or by the scan tool. With our sensor, 5 wires, grey, nominal battery voltage, white, pulse ground for heater control, black, reference high, yellow, reference low, and the pink or red cable signal is the one we're going to focus on. So these measurements are being taken from the red cable, only the red cable, which actually carries current, as seen by the ECU, but also voltage. So, red channel, red cable. So channel 2 is looking at voltage from the wideband sensor, and we're still connected to the air mass meter. So, let's have a look what we've got. So let's just concentrate on the red image, and we're going to use some filtering. We're going to play around with filtering on this. A lot of background noise in this reference because we're taking a reference from the battery negative terminal. You can see the transition in voltage. Now I mentioned 5 circuits, black and yellow, reference high, reference low. Reference high is 2.8, reference low is 2.2. Provided the voltage is between those two references, you're at lambda 1. So let me first of all bring two cursors down and set them to an arbitrary value of 2.8 and 2.2. A bit higher, 2 volts, 2. Now that, folks, is pretty much as near as makes the difference. 2.8, 2.2. And you can see that the output voltage is between those two references. It doesn't matter if it doesn't switch. It does matter that it remains between the two values. And if it does, it's at lambda 1. We'll come back to the other events later. So, if it goes above the upper reference, there is an excess of oxygen. I'm not going to use the word rich and lean. I'm trying to avoid that. If it goes above the 2.8, it has an excess of oxygen. If it goes below it, it has a deficiency of oxygen. So let's just do an ordinary acceleration event and see what happens. I'm going to capture that. Now you notice how quick the recovery is, and it doesn't have this overswing which zirconia sensors do. It corrects within one event back to lambda one. They're introduced because of very lean ratios now with modern combustion principles. So, and they are now very commonplace, both in diesel and in petrol vehicles. Let's focus. You can see that without applying a throttle, the voltage remains between the 2.8, 2.2 reference. Green is current. We'll come back to current in a minute. We open the throttle. Now, we've already established a conversation regarding the air mass meter, converting digital to analog, blue, digital to current, black, and now superimposing on top of that the performance of the lambda sensor during an acceleration event. The purpose of this is to prove that the supply of fuel into the engine is both correct and prompt. So what are we actually proving there? Priming, pressure, flow, filtration, flow rate through the filtration, the response of the mass meter load device, the request APP sensor, accelerator pedal position, correct control, this is direct injection, correct control of the pressure regulating device, correct operation of the injectors, that's opening time and current, and volumetric efficiency, delivery rates, spray pattern, and the combustion process. I've used all my fingers up, an incredibly vast array of potential things to go wrong. This test proves pretty much all of those. The other way you do this, of course, on the road dynamically, take your scan tool, look at AFR, look at request, actual, specified load, look at lambda, specified actual, and look at your tables. But we're doing it with a scope. And here we are, because we want to look for discrete errors in fueling efficiency, perhaps predicting if there's a problem with injectors before we take them out and put them in our RAS new flow bench. This is the predictive bit. So let's have a look at the prediction. Let's zoom into this. Right, well, first of all, we can prove exactly when load request changed. And that's when we get an increase from the flow across the air mass meter. So let's use our first marker. Now that is the instance of increase in airflow. And as a response to that, then we expect the engine control system to start providing the right amount of fuel. Now that occurs within this signal. Now I've actually expanded this signal too much. We've lost some of the scaling. Let me just rescale this. Let me go back and rescale it. You'll see a reason why in a moment. The reason I've rescaled it, I've mentioned this scaling business a few times now. It's important because it's the perspective that you look at that often gives you the most information. I've marked the point of load request. Now, with the voltage, when the voltage goes negative down, that's a deficiency of oxygen, that's extra fuel. And when it goes up, that part there represents throttle off, the injectors are turned off. So this big deviation here is reporting the excess oxygen in the cylinder when there's no fuel being delivered. The enrichment is actually quite subtle with a wideband sensor because its performance is such it balances the fuel requirement out quite accurately. And we can see it better on current. We'll come back to a full description of current. When the current flow through the sensor is zero, it's in milliamps, and in this sensor it's plus 5 milliamps, minus 5 milliamps, limit. At 0 milliamps, that's lambda 1. And you can see here that when it goes down, negative current flow, that is a deficiency of oxygen, a rich environment. And we can measure its reaction. So I'm going to put a marker at that point there as it starts to go down. That's reporting the response time in real time of when fuel is added into the combustion process on acceleration, on load increase. And if that load response is correct, it will be around 200 milliseconds. And once again, that statement comes across all engines of all sizes. If the responsive fuel additive is equal to or better than 200 milliseconds, give or take a small variation, then the supply fuel in that engine is absolutely spot on. It answers all of those other questions we suggested earlier on. So, load request occurs when the air mass meter signal increases, fuel additive occurs when the current goes negative, and the response time of that is 271 milliseconds. It's a little slower than I'd like to see, but certainly is in the ballpark. So I've, a reasonable amount of confidence that the fuel is being added to this engine quite efficiently. If it was delayed any more than that, of course, then we need to examine all the other systems I've mentioned, whether it's priming, whether it's delivery through the injectors, or response from the high pressure pump, of course. So we're looking at voltage from the lambda, voltage transition between 2.8 and 2.2 equal to lambda 1. We're looking at a negative. You can see here it's gone below 2.2 here. Below 2.2. Now, all right, let's apply some filtering, because I'll tell you what, I'm looking at that and there's not enough detail in it. I promise you we'd do a bit of filtering. So, red channel, input. I'm going to select active filtering. Now, straight away, you're going to say that. Whoa, we've achieved it. Lovely. Let's play about with the threshold of frequency and see how important it is to get the right threshold for filtering is on the production of a usable signal. So what I want to do first is increase the threshold, and you can see I'm adding noise back in. It's allowing a higher frequency to pass the filter. And by going the other way, by reducing the maximum frequency it passes, I can actually reduce it to a very, very fine trace. Now, a word of warning here, guys. You could end up filtering out something which you later rely on. Sounds a bit legal, that, but there we go. In this case, it's a low frequency event, so I'm actually quite happy to leave the amount of filtering at that level. Perhaps add a touch more back. Let's add just a little touch of... Notice this very subtle change in detail here. One more. No, I'll tell you what, let's go back one. I'm done. I'm happy there. Now then, we can actually see when this value goes negative, and it starts to go negative here, and goes under 2.2 volts, we have a rich environment in the cylinder. On overrun, it goes way above 2.8 with all the oxygen in the cylinder, no fuel, and then recovers very quickly within the 2.2, 2.8 range. Current, if we bring it up and overlay it, 0 is lambda 1, negative current is a rich environment, positive current is a lean environment, back to lambda 1. ECU looks at current. So we're looking at the air mass meter, we're looking at the wideband sensor, we're looking at the response time of the fuel response against the two, load request and fueling response, to get a very accurate indication of if the fuel's getting in that engine quick enough. And from that then we can develop a process of further testing, should that be necessary. Pressure, flow, delivery rates, atomization, swirl flap control, there's a hell of a lot goes into direct injection these days. But the prediction is done from what I call a focused, I hope fairly simplistic set of processes involved, to be able to further develop the next stage of diagnosis and repair.